Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Blessed be the kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord.
A reading from the first book of Samuel. On the day of Elkanah's sacrifice, he would give portions of his wife, Peninnah, to all her sons and daughters, but to Hannah he gave double portion, because he loved her, though the Lord had closed her womb. Her rival used to provoke her severely, to irritate her, because the Lord had closed her womb. So it went on year by year. As often as she went up to the house of the Lord, she used to provoke her. Therefore, Hannah wept and would not eat. Her husband Elkanah said to her, "Hannah, why do you weep? Why do you not eat? Why is your heart sad? Am I not more than 10 sons? After they had eaten and drunk at Shiloh, Hannah rose and presented herself before the Lord. Now Eli, the priest, was sitting in the seat beside the doorpost of the temple of Jehovah. She was deeply distressed and prayed to the Lord and wept bitterly. She made this vow, "O Lord of hosts, if only you look on the misery of your servant and remember me, and not forget your servant, but will give to your servant a male child, then I will set him before you as a Nazarite until the day of his death. He shall drink neither wine nor intoxicants, and no razor shall touch his head." As she continued praying before the Lord, Eli observed her mouth. Hannah was praying silently. Only her lips moved, but her voice was not heard. Therefore, Eli thought she was drunk. So Eli said to her, "How long will you make a drunken spectacle of yourself? Put away your wine." But Hannah answered, "No, my lord. I am a woman deeply troubled. I have drunk neither wine nor strong drink. that I have been pouring out my soul before the Lord. Do not regard your servant as a worthless woman, for I have been speaking out of the great anxiety and vexation all this time. Then Eli answered, Go in peace. The God of Israel grant the petition you have made to him. She said, Let your servant find favor in your sight. When the woman went into her quarters, ate and drank with her husband, and her countenance was sad no longer. They rose in the early morning and worshiped before the Lord. Then they went back to their house in Ramah. Elkanah knew his wife, Hannah, and the Lord remembered her. In due time, Hannah conceived and bore a son. She named him Samuel, for she said, I have asked him of the Lord. The word of the Lord. The canticle today will be the Song of Hannah. The canticle will be read responsibly by whole verse. My heart exalts in the Lord. My strength is exalted in my God.
My mouth derives from my enemies, because I rejoice in my victory.
There's no holy one like the Lord. No one besides you. There's no rock like our God. For the Lord is a God of knowledge, and by him actions are weighed.
The mighty are broken, but the feeble bear strength.
Those who were full have hired themselves out for bread, but those who were hungry are fat with spoil.
The bear has borne seven, but she who has many children is forlorn.
The Lord kills and brings to life. He brings down to Sheol. Raises up.
The Lord is poor in his heritage. He brings low and also exalts.
He raises up the poor from the dust. He lifts the needy from the ash heap.
The king is the sacred of the princes, and the heir of the seed of honor.
For the pillars of the earth are the Lord's, and on them he sets the world.
He will guard the feet of his faithful ones.
The Lord, his adversary, shall be shattered. The Most High will thunder in heaven.
Amen.
came out of the temple, one of his disciples said to him, "Look, teacher, what large stones, or what large buildings." Then Jesus asked him, "Do you see these great buildings? Not one stone will be left here upon another. All will be thrown down." When he was sitting on the Mount of Olives opposite the temple, Peter, James, John, and Andrew asked him privately, "Tell us, when will this be? And what will be the sign that all these things are about to be accomplished?" And Jesus began to say to them, "Beware that no one leads you astray. Many will come in my name and say, 'I am he,' and they will lead many astray. When you hear of wars and rumors of wars, do not be alarmed. This must take place, but the end is still to come. For nation will rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom. There will be earthquakes in various places. There will be famines. This is but the beginning of the birth pangs." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Today's Old Testament lesson is one of the deeply spiritual and deeply human stories that can help us connect to Scripture as the stories of ourselves and other humans just like us. At its core, this story is about faithful prayer and about trusting that God will accept every part of every thought, of every emotion that we bring in prayer. Hannah's struggles with infertility are just like the ones playing out every day in the lives of families and especially women today. The deep scars, the hurts that these struggles leave are often hidden, carried in secret. What's worse, the culture of the Israelites at this time also places an accounting of God's favor on the number of children that a woman has, adding to Hannah's isolation. Her barrenness means that Hannah sits very close to the bottom rung of her home, her community, and even her whole country.
The story is human, but it is also a story, and in it, names matter, as it does in many scripture stories. The name Hannah means grace. The implication being that she is both graceful and that in this narrative story, she is an incarnation of grace as an ideal. So, it's grace embodied that cries out for justice in these silent prayers that are misunderstood by the priest, Eli. A name that means high or exalted. Framed then with that understanding, it's grace's painful struggle, misunderstood by the exalted, that we heard about today. Now, the narrator of this story doesn't tell us that Hannah deserves any of this pain or that she is sinful in any way. We're told instead that her husband loves her so deeply that he doesn't care if she bears children the way their culture tells him to, and gives her double what he gives anyone else from the sacrifices he makes. That kindness and that love doesn't insulate Hannah. She's unjustly mocked by her husband's other wife, perhaps all the more. This broken relationship between Hananiah and Hannah literally adds insult to injury. It's no wonder that Hannah seeks out God in the temple and weeps bitterly in prayer. If this were some other point in history, without a pandemic haunting us, I like to think that we would each have had a chance to meet and share a coffee or perhaps a meal by now. As we talked, you might see me, as I sometimes do, looking up towards the sky as I'm talking to God. It's a way I offer little prayers. Some of them ask for guidance. Others point out very particularly that it's God's idea for me to be a priest. I just said yes. And still others are yearning for peace. Each of those prayers that I offer in that way touches a place inside me, which then lays open as a place for God to move in my heart and to change me. I pray this way because I know that the work of prayer is being present and open, maybe even vulnerable to God. Those casual comments aren't the only way that I pray, though. Sometimes I do it here with all of you. Other times I seek out silence and darkness, try to still my heart as a way to help me listen for God. At other times, I come here alone and I chant the noonday office. But at the hardest times, I pray with shouts. I tear into God, cursing through my tears. And yes, that is still a prayer. If I believe anything, it's that God loves us in the midst of our lives. The good, the bad, all of it. And I believe that God wants us to bring our cares and our thanks, our joys and our pains to Him in prayer, however we can. Joy or tears, just like Hannah. I want you to hear this. You have permission to pray from every part of your heart. Too often, we tell ourselves that God doesn't want to hear this again, so we stuff down exactly that thing that God hopes we'll share. Hannah's prayer, asking for a child, collects together her desires to share her love as a mother, her hope to be seen as valued by God, and her aspirations to take her rightful place as a faithful member of God's people. But more, she is grace, seeking justice. She has done nothing wrong. She believes she's being punished. But her prayer is offered honestly. And then, after all of this, after the words of Elijah who misunderstood her and then blessed her, after all of this, she goes out to do the work she thinks must be done for God to work the justice in the world that she has just prayed for. She takes up upon herself the work she thinks God will do. In 2 weeks, we will enter into Advent, the season of the church year that prepares us for the arrival of a child who will bring justice and grant peace. He will be the ultimate answer to Hannah's prayers. As we begin to look ahead to that time of expectant waiting, we can learn from the example that Hannah set by bringing our hearts to God in prayer, in silence, in rage, in hope, in thanks. It is my prayer that God give us the bravery to be vulnerable, to allow God to move our hearts after we pray, to do what we believe God is calling us to do through prayer. Amen.
prayers of the people. Let us pray for the whole state of Christ's Church and the world. Almighty and ever-living God, when the Holy Word has taught us to make prayers and supplications and give thanks for all men, receive these our prayers, which we offer unto the Divine Majesty, beseeching thee to inspire continually the universal Church with the spirit of truth, unity, and concord. Correction. There'll be a period of silence after each bid, during which you may offer your own prayers, either silently or loud. I ask your prayers for God's people throughout the world, for Justin, the Archbishop of Canterbury, for Michael, our presiding bishop, Susan, our bishop, and Chip, our priest, for this gathering, and for all the ministers and people. Pray for the church. I ask your prayers for peace, for goodwill among nations, for those serving our country overseas and their families, and for the well-being of all people. Pray for justice and peace. I ask your prayers for the poor, the hungry, the oppressed, those in prison, and the sick, especially Anita, Becky, Bill, Carrie, Catherine, Chris, Donna, Doug, Edie, Eleanor, Gloria, Greg, Judy, Kathy, Marty, Mary, Nettie, Piper, Peter, Shannon, Sean, and Ted. Pray for those in any need or trouble. I ask your prayers for all who seek God, for a deeper knowledge of Him. Pray that they may find and be found by Him. I ask your prayers for the departed. Pray for those who have died. Praise God for those in every generation in whom Christ has been honored, especially St. Paul, our patron. Pray that we may have grace to glorify Christ in our own day.
Heavenly Father, you have promised to hear what we ask in the name of your Son. Accept and fulfill our petitions, we pray, not as we ask in our ignorance, nor as we observe in our sinfulness, but as you know and love us in your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor.
We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not
I'd like to welcome all visitors today. There are cards in view that you'd like to fill those out and put them in your collection plate. Our loose plate offering for today is designated to the Union Mission Ministries. If you've not returned your estimate of giving cards, please do so as soon as possible. And if you need a card, they're on the table back in the narthex. Lastly, as Chip mentioned, the Advent begins on Sunday, November 28th, and we're going to make Advent wreaths after that service, after the 10:30 service that day, and up to 25 people will be able to participate. And if you're interested, please contact Amber Reeves. Her information is in the bulletin. Thank you. As you might have noticed by the sharpness of the gentleman assisting us with worship today, we are also celebrating an armed services Sunday. If you are currently serving or have served in uniformed services in this country, we would like to let you know that we support you and all that you have done for justice and peace in this world. We ask that you stand now to receive a prayer. Lord God Almighty, whose name the founders of this country won liberty for themselves and for us, and lit the torch of freedom for nations yet unborn, grant that we and all the people of this land may have grace to maintain our liberties in righteousness and peace. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. He stretched out his arms on the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he gave thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took a cup of wine. And when he gave thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ is God. Christ is risen. Christ is coming again.
We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. For following his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit. All honor and glory are yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
Now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever.
God, Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you always.